right, welcome everyone. We're ready to go. Good to go. Welcome all to the Montpelier City Council. Our first item of business is to review and approve the agenda. Do we have any changes here? No changes? All right, so without objection, we'll consider the agenda approved. Next item is general business and appearances. An opportunity for anyone who's here, and I see people here for things that are on our agenda, so I'm just going to assume nobody's here to talk about something that's not on the agenda. Welcome, all of you, and so when we get to you, we're glad to look forward to hearing from you. Next item is the consent agenda. Do we have a motion to approve that?
Also move.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, Brian, don't waste any time here. Welcome. Mountaineers update. And Richard.
And Arnie's going to join us from the city as well,
great.
Just to
good.
Kind of have our city hats on, too.
Absolutely. So welcome, Arnie and
thanks.
Richard and Brian.
Great, thanks. So I thank you for having us back, and we wanted to just take a few minutes to talk about the proposal down at the rec field for this coming summer that we'd like to pay for from the Mountaineers. We'd like to pay for and put this little benefit in, I think, for the use of the city as well as for the team during the season. Does everybody have the packet? I gave Bill copies of the drawings.
It was attached.
On the website.
It was on the agenda.
Was it attached? Okay, so what we wanted to do was just go through the drawing and just talk a little bit about it. The idea is to add handicap accessible seating to a grandstand that's very old. It's almost 80 years old. So there's no handicap access down there at all. So the idea would be we've had a local architect look at this, come down, as well as DeWolf Engineering came down to make sure it was structurally sound to do this, and they both gave it the green light. Talked to Arnie he's talked to the rec board, and I suppose they are in approval of it as well. But the idea would be to take a cutout 12 feet out of the grandstand in the first section right there. And according to the engineer, that would be the best spot to do it. It's easy coming into the ballpark where they don't have to go very far to get into the handicap area, and makes it easy in and out without having as much traffic in the middle. Ideal seating, and right now there's no handicap accessibility in the grandstand, so in the past 15 seasons we've had a special area down the first baseline, which the fence was a little bit higher, but it's just not part of being in the crowd. So this way, people in wheelchairs can be in there, be in the crowd, and there's a seat on either side as well, so that somebody coming with that person could be there sitting next to them and make it more of a friendly environment. So that would be the proposal. We hope to do this, if approved, as soon as the weather gets a little bit better, in April probably, so it'd be ready for June 5th opening night. So,
any questions for Brian? Yes, Rosie.
So I understand that you guys are proposing to pay for it, which mm-hmm. all sounds great. But it does sound like there's a possibility that we could use some of our ADA revolving loan funds to pay for this, since it is a city facility.
Sure.
And it sounds like city staff want to do a little more looking into that. Mm-hmm. But I just want to throw that out there. And it sounds like we don't need to make a decision on that tonight. We can give you the go-ahead to do this tonight, and then if we are able to use those funds for it.
Oh, that'd be great, for sure. I mean, we had a donation for the use of, as we saw fit, to make the facility better, and doing a little bit of work in the press box to make it so the roof doesn't leak, and doing the handicap seating. But if that was paid for through some grants, we could find some more uses down there for the money, which would be great. So,
and just to be clear, I would only be proposing using that
sure.
those funds, because my understanding is we're trying to find ways to spend down those ADA revolving loan funds that are just sort of sitting there without a good use. So for the other counselors, that's where
I free up money then for
yes.
you to use, and I'm sure you got a long list of
yeah.
those projects.
Yeah, the lights are 15 years old. They're starting to go. The bulbs are very expensive, especially if we do the 64 light bulbs at over $100 a piece, and hopefully we can get some LED lighting, which would be more expensive. But again, that's a capital improvement we'd like to make down the road, as well as bathroom facilities. Right now, they're not handicap accessible. We do a portalet that is, but as you know, the bathroom facilities are a lot of money to renovate and put new facilities. So that could be something we start fundraising for in the future.
I was just wondering if you had an estimate of cost, because there's nothing in here talking about cost.
The estimate we had was $8,500 to just do this part of the work without the press box. So it'd be $8,500 for this, and the contractor we're using is talking about, we've got one bid right now. We've got two more potential bids on it, but the first one we had in was $8,500. And we may be able to trade some of that out for sponsorship, for game night sponsorship. So we hope to knock it down by $1,500 if they're willing to do that. But either way, we've got the money set aside to pay for it with the $8,500.
This is a really thoughtful proposal. It's nice to see that, especially, you know, the attention to detail here in terms of having seating right next to wheelchairs so that families can be together, or having the rail on the back side of it. Really well thought out, and I'm glad to also hear you just acknowledge restrooms, that it's on your radar, and certainly any width or transition in pavement coming from the parking lot to the seating, I'm sure is something you thought of as well.
Yeah, the biggest thing with the paving was we actually had Pike was willing to make a donation, a one-time donation to fix the pavement, which is 15 years old. We did the pavement originally. It's full of holes. It's pretty bad right now. Arnie made a good point in talking to the city that, you know, we could get that pavement and have it put down there to make a nice smooth surface going in, but within a year or two, it's going to be heaved up because it really needs to be dug down and put some fill in and then have it done the right way with grading. So I think the city's going to use a little bit of just patch for the summer and get it ready, and then hopefully when we do the paving at the pool at some point and just there, we'll do it the right way and then use the donation from Pike, which is a significant donation of pavement. So make sure that it's done the right way down the road is the plan, I guess. So, yeah, it's been a good working relationship between the Mountaineers and the city and trying to make sure we don't just throw the money in and then have it come back 2 years later to have to do something different. We're trying to make sure it's done well. So, thanks.
Thanks for all you are all doing to make the Mountaineers successful here in Montpelier. It's great to go in the summers and see how full it is, and people love it. So thank you.
Thank you. And just a quick update on the last thing we talked about last year was the beer garden. And I know we said we would come back with an update a year later. It's a year later. We're happy to say that it was successful. There weren't any issues. Three Penny did an incredible job of making sure that things went smoothly out there. And the one small little complaint that we had from people was that if a parent came in and they were having a piece of pizza and they have a four-year-old with them and they're in the beer garden watching the game from those seats that are pretty nice in the picnic area, the kids coloring, we couldn't let the kids come in with the parent, which made it a little awkward to have a six-year-old wait outside the fence where the parents were there. And they said it'd be nice if it was similar to a restaurant where if you're, you know, in a restaurant, you have a glass of wine, the kids can be there. And talking to Bill Frazier, he felt, yeah, that makes sense. It doesn't seem to be a problem. The kids aren't going to be allowed in there without an adult, and the bartender's obviously not going to serve a kid. So that was something we wanted to bring back just to say that it was on our radar from some of the comments that we had last year, and just to kind of ask for permission or ask for approval on that being okay this year, as long as the people.
I'm surprised that's something that's in the city control. I mean, I would certainly support that. I think I may have mentioned this before. I just think our outdoor consumption laws are so anachronistic, where we pen people away from, you know, whether it's a concert or a baseball game rather than letting them have a beer in a stadium. But certainly what you're suggesting.
It sounds like it. Bill didn't think it would even have to be a city-approved thing, but we just said we're going to bring it up anyway just to say, hey, this is one of the concerns we had, and it doesn't seem to be a problem. Obviously, the Three Pennies not going to be serving a six-year-old, and they're there with an adult, so it shouldn't be an issue, but we just wanted to at least put it out there in public that we were thinking about this year.
Okay, well, do we have a motion to approve the proposed revisions to the stadium?
So moved.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? I just want to say I do certainly support your from my perspective, the perfect use of the ADA funds. So
yes, thank you.
Decide to pursue.
If we would like to work with the city as well to try to figure out this bathroom situation. We've done a lot of work down there, but the lights and the bathrooms are the two next projects that we'd like to take on, and those are the ones we hear the most about, the lines in the restrooms, the fact that they're not ADA compatible. So if we could work with the city to get some funds and maybe matching funds where we could match some funds that we could get from a grant, you know, we certainly could work towards that goal. So.
Great. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Great. Okay, thank you all.
Thank you
again for all your work.
Thank you.
Good luck this season.
Okay, thanks.
Good job. Okay, unless Sue tells me I can't do this, I think we should, or anybody objects, combine four public hearings that I don't look like we've got anybody here. So this is an opportunity for where we are holding a public hearing now on our budget, the warning for the city meeting, the bond, and the proposed charter amendments. And Todd, you're just going to briefly.
I'm actually going to allow Assistant City Manager Sue Allen to run this PowerPoint, but I'm here.
I'm going to ask. I don't think, given that nobody's here, I don't
think it's necessary.
It's all information everyone has seen.
Everyone has seen, and I'll just remind the public.
It's been warned. We've all been seeing it.
It's in this book, and you can pick these up now at City Hall if you have questions about it.
Is it available on the website yet?
It is. Click on the website and scroll down about halfway down the page, and you'll find it on the website.
The warning is also on the website.
Yes.
The budget's on the website.
Mm-hmm. And all of those are attached to tonight's agenda as well.
And voting's open for early or absentee votes. So if anyone has any questions, we're always available.
Okay, great. Thank you. So nobody present or offer comments, so close the public hearing. Thank you, Todd.
Thank you.
Okay, next item is the Parkwood ordinance. So do you want to just briefly refresh our memories about where we are on that?
On your desk, the first reading was drafted by our city attorney, Paul Giuliani, and it was passed with some changes and some requests from you. On your desk, you should find two versions. One is the red line that shows the changes, and the other is second reading as with the changes accepted. It's pretty obvious. You asked for a definition of what parklets were, and that's been added. The Planning Department and the Department of Public Works asked for a little bit more guidance in terms of where they'd go, what they'd look like, how big they'd be, how far from the curb. The city attorney asked that some language be added to sort of protect the city if there are problems and we need to remove them, to make sure that it's the applicant that pays and that the city's not on the hook for paying to remove them. So those are some of the changes that show up redlined in your version for consideration tonight.
Okay. Thank you, Sue. Rosie, I know you had raised some concerns with the
I can just kind of go
through those.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the first one is, I believe I recall correctly, and this was a long time ago, so maybe I'm not remembering, but I thought that we were all sort of in consensus that we wanted the parklets to be open to the public if the business that sponsored them wasn't open at the time. So the example given was that, you know, Positive Pi had allowed the public to use the parklet before and after their business hours. I personally would still be in favor of requiring the public to be able to access the parklets at all times since it is public land. But I know that I'm in the minority on that, so I just want to make it very clear that a business couldn't have a parklet and then, when they're not open, keep the public from accessing the parklet. So to solve that, I propose under section, it's the second page.
Rosie.
Section six?
Right under bike racks.
Yes. Six.
See the list and it ends with bike racks.
I'm very confused because I have written down where I wanted to insert it and I'm not seeing it anymore. But right above section seven.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
there you're
right.
Yep.
Saying it.
Oh,
so right
yeah,
after
okay.
where it says parklets may be restricted to use by patrons of a particular establishment or group of cooperating businesses, comma, and then I would insert during their operating hours, I guess there would be no comma, it would be or group of cooperating businesses during their operating hours, comma, or may be open to the general public for their enjoyment. And that would ensure that the public could access the space when the business wasn't open. So I would
Remove that?
To make that change.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second it.
Is there a discussion?
I'm really concerned about the liability that that could create for businesses. Like, they have to take out an insurance policy. I mean, if they're not even operating during that time, why wouldn't we allow them to close that space? I mean, we're basically asking them to be on the hook for liability at all times at that point, even though they might not be open for business.
Not sure. Interesting. Justin?
Remind me again, did we make any changes in this proposed second reading language for the fees? Is it still 810? Is that our number that we're working with?
That's the number we're working with.
Okay. Because I agree with what you're saying, Ashley, and I also am thinking of the one that we already have in Positive Pie, and the likelihood that to open for business, they're going to need to do some general cleaning just from the dust, from the air, but also if there's garbage or vandalism or anything that occurs as a result of public usage, that then will be a liability to the physical parklet that they have paid to design. And so I would be very open to exploring a reduction in these fees to businesses to help compensate for higher insurance premiums or additional maintenance and damage that may occur as a result of opening the space up to the public.
I guess the question I'd have is whether Positive Pie's had any problem. I mean, it's open to the public.
It is.
And I'm there a lot just because I work there, and I haven't seen.
By its sheer design, it's open, and people use it. And liability is strange. It's usually not by the hour. I'll bet you they're already paying max liability insurance for themselves. But it's so pleasant to see people there all the time when they're not using it. It seems much more communal. So I would prefer that they be more open, not less.
Okay, so we have a motion, right? You made the motion, and there was a second.
Yep.
Is there further discussion?
Is this something that we should run by the city attorney, the question of liability? We could give our consent based on city attorney approval.
Well, we can do whatever we want, I guess. We can approve it. If we approve, I mean, I would like us to approve the ordinance tonight. So then the question is, I'm not sure.
We could revisit it if it turned out.
Could also amend the ordinance if it looks like it's a problem.
That would be fine with me.
Okay,
I wanted one other just clear. I heard at the end of the last sentence in that last paragraph of section 6, during operating hours, and was there additional language that you were suggesting be added there? Or that was it, period?
Oh, during their operating hours, but then it continues. So it's just inserting it in the middle of the sentence. So then the sentence continues, or maybe open to the general public for their
restricted
enjoyment.
During their operating hours.
So the business has the option to restrict it or to open it to the public.
Okay, thank you.
Any further discussion?
I'm not going to vote in favor of that, but I'm wondering if you might mean to insert the word only in there. Parklets may only be restricted to use by patrons of a particular establishment or group of cooperating businesses during business hours. I think that's a little more clear because that way it can only be restricted.
Mm-hmm. Okay, without objection, we consider that motion to be amended. And is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed?
Nay.
Okay. Got another?
So, yep. Couple more. I wanted to discuss if we want to limit the number of spaces in a row that can be used. So we're putting a max cap of 6 on them. Right now we've got Positive Pie with 2 in a row. That seems fairly reasonable, but I'm thinking if somebody, not even one individual, but if a bunch of businesses wanted to do 6 in a row, that starts to really prohibit parking in front of certain businesses. So maybe we want to have some kind of limit on the number in a row. Maybe that's resolved by, our review process, because our review process does look at location a little bit. But I just wanted to throw that out there.
Maybe the language is not clear, but I believe the intent of up to 6 was that was the max that we would put out there.
And
so some might have 1, some might have 2. So in the process of looking at the applications, I think I'd like to leave it in the hands of those reviewing the applications for that year.
Well, ultimately, it also has to be approved by the city council.
Yes.
True.
It's down to council thought. This is out of scale. They could just say no.
Okay. I just wanted to discuss it, so.
Okay. We might get some gorgeous proposal, you know, and try it. It's bigger than.
Next one. Oh, unless anybody else.
The only question that I had, and I read this a couple times, and I could have missed it, that is entirely possible, is there, so the goal, I mean, these typically exist for, like, late spring, summer, and part of fall, I think until November 8th. Is there, like, an application deadline that might be able to address some of that? Like, if all applications are due by a set date, and then they go through the review process, so the city can consider all of the applications so that that kind of thing doesn't happen?
There's no application deadline written in here. Yeah. Some of the permitting requires 30 days, and so we were thinking we would need to remind businesses well in advance that they're going to have to get permits because they don't happen overnight. But there is no deadline written in here.
It just seems like that might be the way to get at that, so everyone has an equal mm-hmm. opportunity to apply if they have parklet plans or aspirations. Then that way everyone has the same opportunity to apply. The city can weigh all of them, and then...
Problems we haven't had, you know, we've only had one, and so my concern would be the deadline passes, and then somebody wants to put in a parklet, and they have to wait a year because of a, you know, you get an annual, presumably an annual process, but we just haven't had anybody other than Positive Pie express an interest in other, so, I guess the one on Main Street that, or State Street that had to be removed.
I would suggest doing the deadline and then saying they would be accepted on a rolling basis after that.
Oh, okay. So like, you'd have one deadline begin, and then
right. And then if there are any spots left after this, we will continue to accept applications until all spots.
On a rolling basis right. throughout the summer. So if somebody wants one in August, then no one has filled it.
Makes sense.
So how will we write that? But what, in, I mean, if it takes 30 days, if the permitting process is 30 days, and the goal would be to have it, I mean, I don't know, Vermont winters seem to last forever, but if the goal were to have them up by May or June?
May is the...
We said tax day, April 15th.
Yeah. I mean, the first is the day.
May 1st.
So May 1st.
So yeah. Section 4 now says that applications will be handled on a first-come basis or may be amended as needed.
With, I think maybe if we said, like, with preferential review given to those applications submitted by March, whatever, 30th.
But then how would that work in subsequent years? Like after the
well, I thought
two,
we allowed them
years.
To renew for three.
So then next year, what? That date, would that be the same date every year?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then people would know which ones were, are going to be in existence for the next couple of years.
It seems to me you need little more time than that, because if they need 30 days April 31st, and then you're going to have it on the land on March, on, you know, built by May 1, more like March 15th.
Probably March 15th would surely make more sense.
I just want to make clear that everyone knows that for this year, though, I mean, obviously that's a really short time frame, and so
I think we don't really expect to have
right.
more than six this year anyway.
Right.
So.
But everybody knows that even if they get it in shortly after that.
Well, so I guess my question, why are we putting in things that could be hurdles? Because we want these, we said we want these things to happen, and they're really not. So why don't we make it as easy? My view is just make it as easy as possible and not put up barriers that might get in the way of people wanting to do it. But it's, you know, it's March 20th, and we didn't get a deadline application.
But at that point, we might have already allotted them to. So this is in the hypothetical future where there's more applicants than spaces. And so how do you manage that? And you want a way of comparing them all to each other at that point.
Well, I think it's here, you know, it's handled on a first come, first serve basis. So, you know, you get an application in, you're in the door.
But I think the concern, though, is that if three different businesses on State Street happen to be abutting and then they all want to choose spaces, I mean, that would be the six spaces. There would be nothing else. And if it's first come, first serve, I know that it's also subject to review, but.
All right, somebody have a motion they want to make?
I don't know how how we would phrase it. I suppose inserting language in section 4, application. applications will be handled on a first come basis, or maybe amended as needed, with maybe review preference for submissions prior to March 15th. Something along those lines.
Preferential review given to those applications submitted by on or before May.
Yes, March 15th.
Before March 15th. Okay.
For the coming year.
Yeah.
You get that. Okay, is that a motion?
Yes.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Any more?
I've got more.
Okay, keep them coming.
So the next one is, do we want to allow advertising in parklets? We don't discuss that, and I think that we don't, but I was open to having some discussion. I think that it makes it opens up a can of worms to allow it, in that then we wouldn't have any ability to restrict what the advertising was, and that might not be stuff we wanted to see in our downtown. So I think we should put in something that explicitly says that no advertising is allowed on the parklets. But
okay. Thoughts about that?
That was a great suggestion, Rosie. And I thought we'd go under parklet may feature. And then you could have like D, except no advertising signs.
Which section?
It's section 6 again. It's right above where we were editing for operating hours. Parklets may feature table chairs, benches, but no commercial advertising. No advertising.
So just as a drafting thing, can we just make an H and say no advertising is allowed on parklets?
Okay.
Yeah.
Todd.
Oh, Todd.
I just want to throw in.
Yes.
You should probably allow them to advertise their own business, obviously. So like Positive Pi, we have the Positive Pi banner on their parklet. That type of thing. So we want to make an exception for.
So
just a theoretical. That's
I'm
just putting it out.
Justin, and then
I don't want any words on it.
So we did just recently finish approving a whole bunch of zoning requirements for this part of town, and in section 6, part D, it says attractiveness and durability of design. So in terms of, I don't know if that addresses or if we could say something about design review. I mean, any area of the city that's already subject to design review, would this not then? Because it's in the public right-of-way, where are we at here with that?
Any sign would have to go through design review.
We already have some restrictions in terms of illuminated lighting and size and location.
Rosie.
What I'm concerned about is that we are the state capitol, and that some enterprising lobby shop decides they're going to get a parklet to advertise whatever their position is, and I wouldn't want our parklets used for that.
Also something,
some like message,
a messaging other than than the sign. So wouldn't that have to go through design review though? I mean, that's the.
I don't know. I mean, it's the city street, so it's.
Once she mentioned it, I just knew I didn't want to see because the park would have any words on it. I mean, they're made to be attractive, and so I don't want to see the business sign on it. I don't want any word signs on it except. Watch your step or whatever, safety signs. And it seemed to be kind to them to tell them up front, no advertising in the parklet space, but no advertising signs.
Other thoughts on this one? What did you make a motion? Do you want to make a motion?
So I guess I would move that we add, you want it after E to insert H?
I would add an H just for drafting.
And say no.
Whatever it is you want to say, however it is you want to say it.
No advertising?
Signs?
No advertising signs?
You're talking about signs, right?
I don't know.
How about this? No advertising signs are allowed on parklets?
Yeah, no Bud Light, no.
So are we putting it under parklets? It seems weird to say all these things that it can feature and then have the last one being something.
No, this is a new.
He put it in the section above under G.
Oh, yeah.
Well, actually, the
you could say.
I'm not sure where parklets may feature. Does that fall under G? I was just going to add a new separate standalone subparagraph.
I think it should be H.
So I think it's H. it's a little confusing because of the A, B, C, D, E.
Those under G, just like 1, 2.
Yeah, that's confusing. So change A through E.
Do we know? I just mean numbering in G all of the subsections, so that way we can reference if there's an issue, we can say C, G, 3.
Okay, so I move that we add a section H to say that no advertising signs will be allowed on parklets.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second it.
Is there further discussion?
I think I would rather just say advertising is not permitted on parklet.
I'm open to that.
All right, without objection, consider the motion amended. Jessica?
I guess I would just acknowledge that it does specifically decide. Cite the design review committee in the top of section 6. So that language already exists in terms of a requirement for an advisory opinion there. If we want businesses to build parklets, I think that it's reasonable that they would communicate that to their customers, that they have invested money to build and put this thing there and paid the fees with the intent, presumably, of having some sort of commerce connected to it. If the intent is to discourage businesses from building parklets, not allowing them to take credit for what they've done in the form of putting the name of their business or some design-controlled advertising on that parklet, I think would discourage businesses from participating in our parklet program. So I'm going to not support this. I would certainly be open to adding more specific language to Section D after attractiveness if we wanted signage put there, but I'm...
I think the concern, though, is that this would be sort of after the fact. This wouldn't necessarily be built into the design process. So DRC will review it for like architectural standards. They will review it to make sure that it meets all of these other criteria in terms of like the width and the height and the distance that it sits in traffic. And you don't have those things typically aren't built into architectural plans. So I think. Or we could even just reference the zoning, you know. I think that allows for wooden signs, right? So if somebody wanted to, like, put a wooden sign on there with the business name, but
I'm more concerned about the messaging and that we really don't have, if we allow some messaging, we don't really have a standing to not allow other messaging that we find offensive.
And I guess I find that more concerning because now we're getting into freedom of speech.
Right. I don't.
Whether or not we should be in that business, I think, is very debatable.
So that's why I'm saying just no signage, that we don't have to make that decision.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
Oh, I was afraid that was going to happen. Man, I'm right down the... Huh. All right, well, this is a challenge. Boy, because I could see... make it easier. Last night here. Well, I guess I'm going to vote no. And the reason I'm voting no is I because of the council review, and I do think it's subject to design review. So I don't want to keep this simple. So anyway. Okay.
Great. Two more. Sorry. Do we want to have a discussion about whether we want to prioritize parklets that are open to the public or open for more hours of the day over private parklets, in the event that we have more than 6 spaces? And maybe there's not appetite to do that. I just wanted to throw that out there.
I think DRC can do that. I mean, they'll review all of these things. I think I'd be more comfortable leaving it to them.
Council could always add more. I don't know. That's not something I would support, but I.
Okay.
But it just—I mean—you feel free to make a motion if you like.
You got your quotas, Rosie.
All right, and I'm sensing there isn't support to do that. So, and then the last one is there's a mention of the city having we reserve the right to undertake the immediate removal of a parklet in the event of an emergency or street maintenance repair. And then later we say that the applicant is responsible for all costs incurred by the city for parklet removal and site restoration after November 8th or otherwise. So technically it does say, and I didn't get that the first time I read this, that the applicant is responsible for the costs of removal, but I think it's not super clear that if there was an emergency street repair and the city had to move it, you know, that the applicant might be on the hook for it. And I also thought maybe we wanted to have a discussion about, is that fair to the applicant?
It'd be expensive. Tom, do you have any thoughts about that? Is there any other precedent for private property owners having to move assets or facilities for street repairs? It's really not an expense incurred and move. Okay.
There may be some incidental damage, how it's hooked to the sidewalk, right. But generally they just butt up against the curb. So
you don't see us taking on any expense to do that, really?
I really don't, but I do think it's incumbent upon the parklet owner to understand that that's a distinct possibility. Have to have that provision to be able to access our utilities.
Of course, yeah.
Okay, thanks. Just, Tom, while we've got you up here, I was also hoping to just have you weigh in. Is there any other language in here that you have thoughts or concerns about as it relates to street operations or anything else that we should be considering here?
Yeah, thanks for asking. No, I've read it and started looking at this a long time ago for the Montpelier Live. The conditions established by Federal Highway for use of the streets, the width, the signage requirements are all there for appropriate protective devices being a street. So, drainage, things like that are important to us, and we look at that with the design.
Okay, thank you, Tom. Are you all set with that?
That was it, yep.
Okay, any other comments, suggestions, changes, amendments? Justin.
Yeah, given that we did make a couple changes here that I think potentially make it a little more challenging for businesses to participate in our parklet program, I would move that we amend Section 8B, which addresses the fees for the parklets, and reduce the number 812 by $200 to help businesses that do want to build parklets. They're shouldering the entire construction costs. But a reduction here would help with paying for any additional insurance premiums that they would incur as a result of having it open for 24-hour public usage or usage in their non-business hours, and any small cleaning or maintenance that was a result of having it open to the public. It's a fairly small amount of money to the city, but I think it would help businesses to know that we have their back and we want them to participate in this program.
So just for clarity, you'd reduce it from 810 to 610?
Correct.
Okay. Is there a second? All right. Hearing no second, the motion is not agreed to. Are there any other motions? Do you have a motion to approve the ordinance?
I'll make a motion to approve the ordinance as amended. Close the second reading.
Is there a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Yes, Rosie, sorry.
I am much happier with where this is right now. I'm still extremely uncomfortable with the idea of us turning public space over to private businesses for such a nominal amount of money. So I am going to vote against the whole thing, but I am very grateful that you all worked with me to improve it, and I think it's in a much better spot.
Other comments? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay, thank you, everyone. So our next item is pump track. We have with us Nolan Langwell and Kip Roberts from the Montpelier Area Mountain Bike Association. Oh, and Arnie as well from the rec department. And even though they've been working with Arnie on this proposal. Welcome, everyone.
Thank you.
apologize. I meant to
give us just a general description of what the pump track is and what you're proposing.
Yeah, absolutely. I apologize. I meant to print out copies for everyone.
Well, we've got them on the attached.
Yeah, you have the 5-page proposal. Yep. So Nolan and I are here representing the MAMBA, the Montpelier Area Mountain Bike Association.
Not the dance club.
Not the dance club. And
we get asked all the time.
We hatched this plan, well, it's been more than a decade since we started talking about it in this town, but basically a pump track is a imported or it can be excavated fill, and it's very low, it's like a BMX track in a circle with a crisscross in the middle, and it's meant to get new riders, especially kids as young as 1 or 2, all the way up to beginners and experts out testing their skills in a very safe, controlled manner. So we brought this proposal to a trail designer in Vermont. Brooke Scatchard works for Sinuosity, or owns Sinuosity, and he has designed a pump track in a number of places, including in Waterbury on River Road, I guess that is, by the skate rink there, which sees lots of use and is at the base of a trail system up on Fairy Hill State Land. So he put together this proposal here with cost estimates and material estimates. We brought this proposal, talked about it with Arnie, went and looked at the site, which is out by the tennis court. You can see on the map there. We had looked at a number of different spots, and it's amazing in all of that grass out there. There's really not that many places you can actually put something even this small. So we found that spot. We think it's a good space right next to parking, pool, the skate park, and with the redo of the North Branch Nature Center and their programming and the accessibility through the corridor crossing through North Branch Park from Cummings Street, this will be pretty accessible to families and kids without adult supervision.
Several years ago, we did a survey of our membership, and one of the big priorities that came out of that was more family-friendly, kid-oriented trails. And so this is part of that. The first thing we did recently was we rebuilt and built some new trails over at Morse Farm, working with the Morse family, and we did it in the middle of the season. It's been a success. The idea was someplace for families to take their kids, ride a mile or two, and then go get a creamy. This is like the next phase of like something that's within the city boundaries. It's sort of part of the bigger structure over there of all the other stuff. And so this is fits within that sort of new context of what we're really aiming to get more family-friendly, kid-friendly biking in town.
You want to talk just a little bit about how this is going to fit with the Parks Department approval of the mountain bike trails in North Branch last week, or 2 weeks, whenever that was, a week or two ago?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because
I don't think the council probably knows anything about that. So maybe
sure. There was a committee that met with, and Mayor Holler was on that committee and some other citizens, and they were part of a bigger trail idea. Make a long story short, I don't know if folks are familiar with the North Branch trails and that off Cummings Road, where there's the walking part and then there's the mountain bike part, and it pretty much just kind of goes straight up the hill all the way up to Sparrow. And so we've been working with the same builder, Brooke Scatchard, to design more what is often called flow trails, and it's just more purpose-built, sustainably built, fun trails off of some of the existing trails. And we had several we went to the Parks Commission multiple times because they wanted to hear more and answer their questions. And finally, they did a big hearing, and over 50 people showed up in support of this, and the Park Commission gave its approval for that. So that's going to be more of a extension of the existing network. That'll be family-friendly, but it'll be a little bit more of intermediate-level trails.
But also multi-use, to be clear.
And multi-use. Everything we build is multi-use, so which means that people can hike them, walk them. And it also includes some of, I think, a little less than a mile of the existing trail, which we will actually fix and make in better shape.
So the idea is that
that obviously with what the Parks Department already has going on out there with the Mountaineers Field and the tennis courts, this is kind of the recreational corridor heading north on 12 there. And so I think the pump track would kind of be part of that hub for biking and then stacked loops of multi-use, including bike trails, up above that in the North Branch Park, which is the proposal, which still has a ways to go, but it has some initial approval. That will all kind of be part of this recreational package, offering more to users beside just the pool and, you know, possibly baseball, football, soccer, et cetera, and adding biking into the mix.
And one of the themes that came up a lot in the public hearing and in the public comments and in the conversation specifically around North Branch was the economic development piece, about looking at the bigger picture of what does this bring to the community. If you look at places like Burke, you look at Stowe, the businesses are seeing a real impact of people coming into town specifically for recreation. Now, are we going to be there? Well, we have a ways to go, but there was some sort of metric that Vermont Mountain Bike Association uses. I apologize.
It's okay, I can hear you.
About that, if you have more than a 7-mile loop, people will actually make the effort to come into town. And Vermont Mountain Bike Association did a study of another trail that was built about 4 or 5 years ago at Blueberry Lake, and that's probably 4 or 5 or 7 miles of trail. And they looked at the economic impact, and they found that there was quite a solid economic. They said there was over $1 million of business brought into the area. Working in fiscal sounds a little bit on the high end to me personally, but I think that you cannot. I think you definitely can't doubt that there has been a boom to businesses. Businesses are feeling the economic development in that area. So while I can't guarantee that this is going to be like, hey, we're going to build this trail and people are going to come, I think that it's a step in the right direction in sort of creating more play, like drawing people to town for one more reason. You know, they're going to come into town, ride bikes, go get a beer, get a burger. So we're hoping that this too could be part of a bigger economic development piece in the city.
And on the flip side, people won't leave town. I worked at Under River Sports for 15 years, and that's what we saw is
every Thursday night we drive out
of town,
right?
Because our one trail in North Branch Park was 1 mile that went from here to here, and it was really not that beginner friendly. So I would take my 8-year-old daughter and family out of town, and we heard that over and over and over again. And I think we're talking about parklets, et cetera. We're trying to keep business in this town.
Okay, questions for these folks, Donna and then Justin?
I attended the Parks Commission, and it was very interesting. There were two groups that do it with adolescents, and the sheer volume of kids involved, I was really impressed. It was a very informational meeting. It was very helpful. Thank you.
And we do usually at least 1 to 3 take a kid mountain bike days per season. We've come and gotten permission. I think it was here the Parks Commission in the past.
Parks Commission.
We did a couple of them in Hubbard Park. And this year we did it at Morris. And now we'll do one at the pump track. We'll do one at Morris. You know, so this sort of fits within that sort of like trying to get kids outside, active.
But one group was for girls, and then there was a gentleman who had a more of a mixed group. Sound like you had a lot of kids.
Yeah,
we had over 90 kids at a 3 series of Take a Kids mountain biking days a couple summers ago, and over 90 kids came to those three different events. And so what I see, this is obviously you can get there from Cumming Street. For the kids, I think it's kind of an economic equalizer as well for the families who can't exactly load up the bikes and leave town to go riding. If a kid has a bike, and if anyone has had children in the middle school, you see those bike racks are overflowing. I mean, talk about infrastructure, we need more bike racks there, which is great. Beyond that, I think we kind of lose these kids because we don't have the opportunity to actually turn them into bikers, which is a lifelong sport. If we don't have the opportunities for them in here in town, they give up on biking, and that bike goes to the bike swap.
What was cool about a pump track is you don't have to have a fancy mountain bike to do it. You can do it on any bike, your kid bike, you know, there's...
This is the Maple Street Bike Park in Essex Junction, and I can pass around if you'd like.
Yeah, we'll just pass it
around. It's right near the pool, and you see kids in flip-flops and bathing suits there on cruiser bikes.
Flip-flops and biking.
Right. I talked to Harlan Smith yesterday, who's the his title has changed, and he wasn't even sure exactly what it was, but he's director of Rec and Park, I believe. And he had a lot of good things to say about the age of kids, 5 to 45 years old, he said, and they would just be out there for hours doing loops on a dirt track that was pretty safe. There had been some injuries, only because theirs actually incorporates medium to large jump lines, which is certainly not part of our proposal.
Any other questions? Rosie?
I think Justin.
Oh, did I miss you? Sorry about
that. That's fine. Either way.
Justin and Rosie.
This is a great project. Thank you guys for helping make this happen. It's exactly the sort of stuff I think Montpelier needs more of. And for $6,000 more or less you're asking for, I think it's very reasonable for the usage, and having it in the rec fields I think is a great choice, because you've got so many kids already riding bikes down there or being down there with siblings for sporting events, or parents who are dropping off kids and now can ride the track. Thank you for helping make this happen. Wanted to touch base with you, Arnie, in terms of ongoing maintenance. It appears as though it's dirt or crushed rock, but you're comfortable with the ongoing liability that this new asset will hold for the rec department?
We actually talked about that, because I invited these guys to our rec board meeting in February, and one of the things they do is work days, where they come in and kind of fluff the track back up, for lack of a better term, because I don't know exactly what they do, but they come in and they get the, you can probably talk about it, getting the track reset.
Yeah, obviously you're going to have some frost heaves due to moisture and whatnot in the spring, so it just kind of gets a refresh and a makeover. I talked to Jay Preventure, I don't think he's a president, but part of the Waterbury Area Trails Alliance, and they don't have a specific contract with Brooks Scatcherd, who also built theirs, to actually do renovations and facelifts every spring. They just do it on a case-by-case basis, but a lot of it they do with their volunteer help. So I actually talked with Tom McCardle earlier today about some concerns, because this is right next to the river. You know, there's some sediment concerns for sure there, and we would be importing this mix of clay, sand, and possibly silt, because it does need to kind of set up. There needs to be some level of erosion control, and certainly we will work with both Tom and Arnie to make sure that we mitigate that as much as possible. Zoning, planning.
Does there need to be a fence?
Rosie,
well,
and then Donna.
Just had one more quick thing.
Okay.
Just wanted to remind you also that a couple meetings ago, this council approved the purchase of roughly 7 acres in additional to Hubbard Park, with the intention of making sure this is on your radar as a potential opportunity for more bike riding in the park.
Yeah, that discussion has certainly been going on for a long time, and I was on the Parks Commission for a number of years there, and the idea in theory was to, this would help create a contiguous Circ Trail around Hubbard Park, which would also possibly be a community connector through what road is that off of 12 there, where you can drop down and actually cross over that one or further where the Quonkas live. Yeah.
North Branch.
North Park Drive.
North Park Drive.
Yeah. So that trail, if a trail got built on that theoretically, that would also help kids get from A to B, not on the road.
So I really support doing this. I actually had a friend with small kids talking to me this fall about how excited they were to go to the Waterbury one, and that they wish there was something like that here in Montpelier. And then Bill put it on the agenda, and I said, oh, what's a pump track? And he described it. I was like, oh, that's that thing that they were talking about. So I think this is great. I just have some questions about the money. So my understanding is that the vendor has said it's $5,000. That MBA is putting forth $2,000, and we're being asked for $3,000, and then there may be $3,000 approximately in additional materials that we may be able to get some of that fill from DPW supplies at no cost, maybe. but the $3,000 should cover it. And maybe
the $3,000 was just the ballpark, because
okay.
I wasn't exactly sure of exactly what they were looking at, of how much, because the part that'll be probably the most expensive is the ball field clay. I'm not exactly sure off the top of my head what that costs, but that comes in bags and we get it by the pallet. But they're generally fairly expensive. But I also noticed in here they want like 140 yards possibly of that material. Is that cubic yards, you know, or is that, that's a lot of material.
Yeah, Yeah, I don't think it's.
So I'm not sure. That would probably be the biggest expense of that part of it. And DPW, I've been in contact and with Bill and Tom in regards to, they might have some construction projects where they might have some extra fill from this summer. And if it's a good enough quality fill that won't contaminate anything, that we might be able to use that for the base and then put the ball field clay over the top of that so you have a compacted material that stays in place.
So tonight we're just discussing the $5,000 for design, of which the city is being asked to contribute $3,000. And MBA would be contributing $2,000.
From the grant. From the grant.
Yeah, that was already awarded from the.
I think
Mount Lake
we're asked to approve the whole project, though, right?
Right.
No, we're not
yes.
going to be coming back for
yeah.
more.
Right.
Okay.
And so I did ask. I have talked to a number of friends through the mountain bike organization about possible clean fill sources. I'm still kind of waiting to hear back. Those, so I couldn't get any estimates, but I did from Brooke Scatcher, the trail designer. He was saying roughly in the $2,000 for 110 yards, 140 yards of base material could be hopefully donated, which doesn't need to be very high quality. And then trucking is the expensive part, which he estimated at $2,000. So this is beyond the five. If we don't get donations or other sources of clean fill. And we had talked with Tom and Arnie about that a little bit, about the Caledonia Spirits, like what other sites and projects going on, as Arnie referenced, where could we possibly find this?
So, and then I understand from Arnie that this kind of came in after our budgeting process, so this isn't in the budget already, and I want to know from Sue or Arnie, kind of where are we planning to, are we just...
Find it.
Yeah, where's it coming from?
My thought would come out of our budget.
Okay.
Figure out somewhere we have some money in the line item. The other option we might have, and I talked to Sue a little bit, I think I talked to Sue about this, is we do have a fund balance. And
okay.
If it's kind of a capital project, maybe we could go in and use some money with council approval out of the fund balance to do this type of project.
Are you talking about a rec fund balance or a general
rec fund balance?
Rec fund balance.
Okay.
So that was my other thought, since it's kind of a one-time project, at least getting started.
Okay. And then I understand that there wasn't like a bid process or anything done for the designer, that this is sort of a collaboration with them. I'm not super comfortable with that, just because it is public money, and I always am supportive of competitive processes. I don't want that to hold this up. I just wanted to throw that out there for other folks. You know, Arnie had said that it was possible to do a bid process.
A lot of times, I'll just speak real quick, a lot of times for us just to kind of get the understanding
sure.
of the project is these guys came to me with already a designer in mind, you know, so it was an easy place to at least get started, but if we had to go out to do a bid process, I mean, that's certainly something we can do. I'm not sure how many designers are in the state that do pump tracks, but I mean, you know, that's always an option. Because I agree most of the time I try to bid it.
I think part of the factor here is it's just so small.
Right. It's a small.
And is it your feeling that this is a pretty reasonable, like, compared to other projects you guys have worked on, that this would be?
This is the builder that built Waterbury.
Uh-huh.
He's built other pump tracks around the state, so he's one of the go-to people. And if there aren't a whole lot of other people.
Yeah.
I think there's only three trail builders in the state that I know of that are doing, like, good, sustainable, well-built stuff. And one's in the kingdom, and so we're comfortable with him. We've seen his work.
You can do it wrong, and it won't last as long. And that's what I would be concerned about. Anyone can move dirt for sure, but to have somebody who has a lot of this kind of design and construction under his belt, but I completely appreciate what you're saying as far as the bidding process.
I just don't want to get in the habit of doing that, but I might be willing to kind of.
Someone who works on the state budget, I can appreciate your question.
And I did have one more. Sorry. I noticed from the aerial view that it looked like it is fairly close to the river, and I wondered, I haven't looked at the spot, so I don't know, maybe this isn't sure it makes sense, but is there any concern that we might need a safety fence there so kids aren't riding off into the river, or is that, maybe that doesn't make sense for that spot?
I think there'd be a pretty solid riparian buffer there, grass buffer. You're right, there is a bank there from flooding erosion. And back to Donna's question, which we never quite answered either, as far as erosion and how to control that. I talked with Tom a little bit about that today, and possibly building up the material on the outside, doing a little bit of perk testing to see what that, how well that soil drains currently, and then possibly sloping everything to one point and then dealing with all the water in one exact spot. We're dealing with some kind of a drainage, but the outside of that pink loop, in theory, could be built up a little bit to keep most of the material there. And it would still have to go, it would have to be quite a flooding or rain event for sand to kind of move across that flat ground. And honestly, it really depends on a couple things during the construction process, exactly how close that is, which you can't exactly say there, but it's not going to be variously hanging over the cliff.
Is this close enough that it gets in trouble with any of our river hazard zoning stuff?
We talked to Audra about this,
okay.
And it's certainly in the floodplain, which actually extends up into the tennis court in a funny little triangle, but it's not in the floodway, which essentially is the river. And from discussions with her, it seemed that bringing fill into the floodplain is okay, floodway, not. This is floodplain. But we'll certainly double check that.
All right, that's it, really?
I appreciate this sort of answer about the conservation and erosion, but I do feel you have to plan for kids. You're encouraging all these ages, and it would seem you'd need something that's a little more buffer protection for their bodies and their bicycles doing things that you wouldn't expect when you get that close. So I hope you'll explore that with your planner, your builder. I mean, certainly he must have experience if all these are used by different ages.
Yes. Certainly, and Arnie runs the camp there, and this actually does create a great opportunity for kids to use it during the camp, and mm-hmm. I don't believe that there's any barrier along there at all. I don't know that this would necessarily be more of a risk, but we will certainly look into that.
Well, you have the bike, not just your body, that can roll. You have you and your bike, and you part ways, and the body could go towards the river. Anyway, I would feel better seeing something of that ilk. And I'm just a little confused about $3,000 plus $3,000 worth of materials. So tonight, you're wanting us to approve, and I'll be glad to make the motion, to have the rec department build the pump track at the rec field. But you're not asking for any appointed money, Arnie. You're just saying you're going to make it work, or do we have to authorize you to use that money to make it work?
Well, I think by approving it, we'd be authorizing Arnie to spend the money either out of his budget or his out of balance.
Okay, should that be in the motion, John?
I think just to authorize you to build a contract.
Okay. So, John Odom, I'll make the motion to approve the rec department's request to build a pump track at the recreational field.
Second.
Second.
Any further discussion? I just want to say thanks. The work, I know Kip and Nolan put a ton of work on this, and Arnie, your receptivity, and I'm sure you put a lot of time and work. But just the one meeting I was at, your openness to think about it. And I think it's going to be a great opportunity for kids. Fits in. It's just been tremendous with this new, more family focused mountain biking trails. Else? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Okay, so we move to council business, our council reports. Rosie.
Warrants.
Sorry.
Your picture.
I guess it would be appropriate to thank our departing members for their service and say it's been a pleasure to work with you all. And we all here understand how much effort it has been, and thanks for your service, and it's been fun.
Thank you, Rosie.
Anne reached out to me earlier. She's sick tonight, but she also wanted to pass on her thanks for all of the work that all of you put in over the last few years, and certainly there have been some trying times, and I echo her sentiment exactly that, the tireless work because of all of you have really set us up to be where we are right now, which is, really worried about the budget process, and it was quite painless thus far. And I, too, thank all of you for your service. I think I can't believe it's been a year already. I was just thinking about that earlier. And it's been a year of exponential growth and learning, certainly, as a new member of the council. And I really appreciate all of the time and effort that you all have spent sort of educating us about how this works and what the process is and how things happen.
Thank you, Ashley. Donna?
The same. Thank you, all three of you. And that I'm glad to hear that we're having a little party so that we can thank you even more abundantly.
Mm-hmm. That's,
apparently it's a party.
Can I say
excluded.
That publicly, the date? 13th?
I don't know. Is there an announcement?
Is this a thing?
We were checking availability, but there will definitely be a little party.
Look forward to a notice of a party.
Jamie had been polling the three of us to find a date.
And I just said you might want to also invite Tom. He would enjoy the party.
Jean.
I would also say thank you to everyone on the council, and I know that we're in good hands with you newer folks. I also know that we've got some good candidates running from District 2. I'm very pleased about that. And it's been a privilege. So thank you.
Thank you, Jean. Jess?
I wanted to make sure all the residents know that the town report is out. It's a beautiful shade of purple, and it's available here at City Hall. There's a lot of really interesting information in here prior to town meeting day. It's also maybe available at other places around town, the senior center,
in the library, post office.
Or reach out to me personally. If you'd like a copy, I'll make sure that one gets brought to you. I also want to thank the residents for allowing me to serve on their behalf, to thank my family for giving me the time away from home to be at these meetings and subcommittee meetings. It's been an absolute pleasure, and I've learned so much. It's really been an honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesse. Well, thank you all first, let me just say it has been an honor to serve the city. You know, this is an incredible place, and so to be able to say you're the mayor of Montpelier has been a real honor to me, because this is a place that people look to in so many ways as kind of a model for what a city should be like, and people love to be here, they like to live here, visit, and so to help to make this an even better place has been a real honor for me. It's been a great pleasure working with all of you. You've been this side a little longer than folks over here, but it's been a real pleasure over the last year with the two of you and then all of you guys. So I'm going to miss that. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. John?
Just really quickly, I want to remind folks that we are open for Saturday voting this weekend, for early voting, 10 to 4 at the clerk's office. That's the only business we'll be doing on those Saturday hours. Also note again that we're having limited service in the clerk treasurer's office on town meeting day. You can come in and make payments for things, but all the things that are specifically focused on clerk functions, you know, licenses of various type, marriage licenses, dog licenses, town research on the land records. Oh gosh, there's a bunch of things in there all like clogged in the front of my head right now. But anyways, there'll be a nice list up, and just we won't be able to do it then. Also, just, you know, thank all you folks leaving for your service. I know it's a lot of time and a lot of grief, but, you know, I always thought public service was about making the world a better place. So thanks for sacrificing a meaningful chunk of your lives to do that, a meaningful percentage of your lifetimes.
Thank you, John.
I'll just quickly echo that from city staff. I know I speak for all of us. I don't think anyone has any idea how much time you all have put in. The meetings are only a small part of what you do, and the meetings, some of the zoning meetings, were going until 11 o'clock at night, and that's just a piece. So thank you very much from all the city staff as well. And speaking of parties, I think everybody knows that Amanda Pelkey's hockey team won the gold for the U.S., and she's due back, I believe she'll be back in Montpelier on Thursday, so sort of keep an eye out. We're going to do some sort of celebration to congratulate Amanda Pelkey and thank her for representing the city so well.
Thank you, sir. I just want to acknowledge my wife, Jennifer, who's probably not going to be happy about me doing this, but
yay,
two things. One, just supporting all of my work here over the years, and it's been a lot of support. But the other is a fifth-generation Montpelierite providing me sort of a grounded level of sort of guidance and wisdom. So thank you. All right, so we have one more item in the city manager's contract that will be in a, we'll presume we will go into executive session. And we may, I'm not sure what we'll do, whether we'll come out of executive session. There's a possibility we would come out and take action on that. So just say that I don't know whether that will happen. But. All right, so do we have a motion to go to executive session to discuss city manager's contract?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed?